All right, back on the Mixed Martial Arts Hour. Ariel Helwani here in our New York City studio. Okay, this is very exciting. We have an in-studio guest. I talked about it before the break. We've been talking about it since last week when they officially announced the Professional Fighters Association, officially announced Thursday morning, and one of the faces behind it, one of the leaders behind it, is our guest in studio right now. His name is Jeff Borris, longtime sports agent, primarily over the last few years working in the world of professional baseball, but he is front and center on this one, and we are privileged to have him in studio here on the show. Jeff, how are you?
Good. Thanks for having me on.
Pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much for joining us here today. Okay, so there's a lot to discuss here. This is a very interesting topic. Okay, here's the first question right off the top. When did you first come up with the idea of launching something like this? When did you first start thinking that this is something that needed to happen in MMA?
Well, it was January, and I was doing baseball salary arbitration cases for the Ballingy Group. And at that time, Lloyd Pearson had just done the first bout agreement with McGregor Diaz. And he came up to me and he said, would you take a look at the bout agreement and the promotional agreement and has have another set of eyes look at it? So I said, okay. And I read it and I couldn't believe what I was reading. Huh. I said, this isn't valid. This isn't enforceable. This won't fly. This has to be changed. And he said, this is the way how the UFC does their business. And then I started learning more and more about it. We went to their headquarters, had a meeting with Lorenzo and Dana. Uh-huh. And I brought it up. I said at the time, I said, Dana, how come these fighters haven't ever unionized? And he said, they're not employees. They're independent contractors, which I thought was a very self-serving statement at the time. And that, you know, he kind of scoffed at the idea. And I walked out of that meeting and I turned to Lloyd and I told him, I said, I'm going to unionize these guys.
Wow. Right then and there. Because of his response.
Not just because of his response, but when I had read their initial agreements. I mean, I've worked in baseball for 30 years, and I think that the Major League Baseball Players Union is the gold standard as far as unions in professional sports. I mean, the rights of baseball players are light years ahead of every other sport. And I said that this just can't happen. With the sale also, I mean, it indicates that the UFC is really the premier league. When you look at Major League Baseball, the NFL, NBA, National Hockey League, it's right up there with them now. And these fighters need representation. I mean, their rights right now are being trampled upon, and it's probably worse than ever. The UFC's profiting, which is okay. They're running a successful business. They're entitled to it. But the fighters, they're the show. They're the ones that drive that business, and they're entitled to be compensated for their efforts.
So prior to seeing that contract, and by the way, I believe it was in February, when they first started, because the fight was March 5th. It happened around 10 days before, right?
Yeah.
The Diaz-McGregor fight.
196.
Yeah. So prior to seeing that contract, you never thought of this at all? I mean, again, you've been around sports for a long time. You've been an agent, represented some of the biggest names in baseball. You've never thought about this. You were never really privy to what was going on as far as the contracts are concerned, right?
Right. I had never looked at a UFC contract before. I had never even given it any thought.
Yeah.
I just strictly worked in baseball, and it was the first time when the contracts were put in front of me that I looked at it and I even started thinking about it.
Were you a fan of the sport before all of this?
I was a fan from day one. I was watching Gracie when he was fighting guys twice his size and laying on his back. I've been a big fight fan for a long time.
So given what you know about the MLBPA and contracts in baseball, you never thought like, you know what, I wonder what those guys are making, how much they're getting, what cut they're making. You know, have you ever, you never had that discussion with anyone before the contract? The contract was the slap in the face?
Well, I first started investigating that at that time. I had thought that these guys were making a lot more money than what they were. And then when I started talking to many of them, and I'm finding out that it cost a lot of these fighters money to fight. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, if you know, I know right now 10 and 10 is the minimum, and that might seem like a lot of money, but for putting your life on the line and going in a cage and against some gladiator for $10,000, that's really not enough, especially when you have to pay your corner, you have to pay your training expenses. There's no types of stipends that are given to these fighters for that. If you talk to all these professional fighters, I bet you at one point or another, they'll tell you it actually costs them money to fight. Mm.
So when you're leaving that meeting, and you turn to Lloyd Pearson and say, okay, I'm going to unionize the fighters, then what do you start doing?
I start doing research.
Okay.
I start doing research. I'm getting everything I can get my hands on that I could read to educate myself. I'm one of those guys that's real cerebral. I got to know everything that there is out there. You know, I mean, it sounds funny saying it. I mean, I feel like an expert in baseball, but I didn't feel like an expert, you know, as far as the UFC was concerned. So I just read everything I could get my hands on. There's quite a bit of information out there too.
Okay. So then when do you actually put this plan into place? Because it's one thing to say I'm going to do it. It's one thing to start researching, but to actually launch the damn thing, you know, when do you start doing doing that, how long did that actually take from, you know, the point of when you're saying, okay, this is what I'm doing, to last Thursday when you guys send out the press release?
Right. Well, it's a process, because this is not a one-man show. I wanted to put a group together, because I've, you know, for 30 years in baseball, I've watched the Major League Baseball Players Association and how they conduct their business. So I want to try to pattern it after that. So I wanted to assemble a group of people. I wanted to get a hold of Don Fear, who had been the director of the Baseball Players Association for years now. He's of hockey. I wanted to talk to Tony Clark. I wanted to get the endorsement of all the major sports leagues, of all their executive directors. I know that I can lean on Don and Tony for help. They've, you know, agreed to advise me at any point in time, lend a helping hand whenever I need it. And I wanted to put the right people in place so that the fighters really get the bang for their buck.
When you reached out to these people, was it just like, okay, we're friends with you, we've worked with you, here's my endorsement? Or were they interested in, wait a second, these fighters don't get this, they don't have these rights, they don't have this association? Like, what were those interactions like? Because if I'm being honest, on your website, I believe it's profighters.org, the thing that really sticks out are those sort of endorsements from the MLBPA, from the NBAPA. I mean, that really smacks you in the face, somewhat unprecedented for our sport. So what were they saying to you? Was it just sort of a favor for a friend, or were they truly interested in your opinion?
Well, the first person I called up was Don Fear, because I've known him the longest. Yeah. I've known him for 30 years and worked closely with him on many situations. And I've been through lockouts, strikes, collusion on multiple occasions, unfair labor practices, all with the Baseball Players Union. And I said, Don, this is my idea. You know, I'm looking to you for help, guidance, advice. Tell me what to do. He said that a group called him like 3 years ago out of Chicago, brought up the same idea to him, said, hey, listen, we're thinking about doing this. And he said he never heard from them again. And he said that absolutely. He said the UFC with their sale, they're right on this, the same playing field as all the major sports leagues. The fighters definitely need that. And now's the time.
Would you have launched the PFA, would you have launched it if the UFC didn't sell for $4 billion a month ago?
Yes, I would have, because I believe them to be enormously profitable anyways. The fact that they sold really doesn't matter. I was full steam ahead. Yeah, so the sale just, I think, adds to the situation, but I would have done it anyway.
Did you know about the sale? Did you know about the talks? Had you heard the rumors? Did you hear anything behind the scenes when you were starting to come up with this? Because this has been said a lot. Oh, they just sold for $4 billion. Here comes this agent who wants to make money off of, you know, the sport, etc.
Right. I had heard lots of rumors out there, you know, and you don't know what to believe. You know, it's rumors are not substantiated. So until it was actually fact, and I think, I mean, even I heard Dana, I mean, maybe a couple days before the sale was official, he was saying that there was nothing. And I understand that there's nothing until it's something. It's the same thing with the Professional Fighters Organization. It's nothing until it's something.
Sure. Did you take the temperature of the community, reach out to certain fighters, reach out to managers, reach out to promoters, and say, look, this is something I'm thinking of doing? Like, you know, it's one, sometimes I feel like, I've said this before, sometimes I feel like the media cares about this stuff more than the fighters. Like, I talk to them about it, and about it, and they're saying like, oh, you know, I just want to fight, I want to support my family. And I get it, because they're focusing on just fighting and they don't want to rock the boat. Did you get the impression from any conversations behind the scenes, on or off the record, that this was needed, this was wanted by the MMA community?
Yes, I definitely went up there and took the temperature of several groups. Okay. It's not just the media that's interested. First thing I did, obviously, was the fighters. I've been talking to them in small groups on an individual basis, and they over, my batting average is 1,000. Every single one of them that I've talked to wants this. There is one common theme, though, and that common theme is a lot of them are fearful, I mean, of the UFC, that they're gonna retaliate against them. You know, what's funny is that inside the octagon, they're courageous, they show no fear. But then outside the octagon, in the business arena, they're scared. They're scared that and I'm trying to tell them, listen, there's rules in this country that prevent employers for preventing employees from organizing. And don't worry, they're not going to retaliate. I mean, I would love to name names of the fighters that I've talked to. I would love to name names of agents. I've reached out to the agent community. I've talked to all of them, because I know as an agent in baseball how much the unions relied upon me to communicate the message to my players. So I'm reaching out to agents as well, and I'm talking to them. And the fear of reprisals is unbelievable. I don't know what the UFC has done to try to bully or create this fear or instill this fear in the fighters, but they've done a good job. And I mean, they tried to even bully you by, you know, taking away your media credential. And I mean,
were you surprised by that response?
Yes. Actually, I thought my biggest challenge was going to be to unify the group.
Yeah.
And I'm finding out that that's really not my biggest challenge. My biggest challenge is to quash their fears about reprisals from the UFC. And I'm telling them they're not going to retaliate against you. Like I said, there's laws in this country. And that's why I'm not going to mention any names. I want to respect them.
Sure, sure.
But when I get the group together, I said, yeah, it's not a fair fight. I'm not going to take one fighter and say, let's just take Connor, for example, and say, Connor wants a union. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to take all 600 of them approximately. I want to get them all because that's going to communicate a message to the UFC and it's going to say, look, they stand together. They're the ones that drive your business. They're not divided. There aren't multiple factions within that group of 600. They stay unified and now it's a fair fight.
Did you tell the UFC before you officially launched this?
No, the only time I did it was when I asked Dana the question when I was in there at their headquarters and I said, have the fighters ever attempted to unionize? And that's when he told me, no, they're independent contractors. And, you know, he said they'd lose their ability to be able to negotiate on an individual basis. And I said, that's not true. I said, look at all the major sports. Their agents go ahead and negotiate for them on an individual basis. There's a disparity in the salaries that are made. That's not going to be any different. It's going to be the same thing. So I think that by calling them independent contractors, a very self-serving statement for the UFC.
And I'll ask you about that in a second, but have you heard from the UFC since you launched this on Thursday?
No, I have not.
No, are you surprised by that?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not so sure.
Okay. What about this independent contractor versus full-time employee debate? This is what people say when they hear, oh, the mixed martial arts fighters, the UFC fighters want to start a union. They say you can't start a union because you're not a full-time employee. What do you say in response? And for the record, you're called the Professional Fighters Association. Did you use the word association because you recognize the fact that they can't be a union?
Yeah, there's differences between an association and a union. Correct. First of all, to be an association, you don't need to be elected. You just call yourself an association. You get members. You're an association. I'm trying to form a union.
Okay.
Okay. Union is different than an association. For instance, as a union, your employees, I'm talking about wages, hours, and other terms and conditions of employment that I'm concerned about. I'm not so concerned about the things that an association is concerned about. And I'm going to give you an example. I'm concerned about minimums. I'm concerned about a pension. I'm concerned about medical insurance, a grievance procedure, a collectively bargained for drug policy, things like that. An association, like I read the MMAFA's mission statement, they're concerned about advancing the rights of the sport through websites, domains, logos, things like that, trying to bring the fighters together based upon race, religion, creed, things of that. I'm all for that. I've read a lot of negative tweets from the MMAFA during the week as if they feel that we're a threat or trying to attack them. Not at all. I endorse what they're doing. I support what they're doing. I support the Ali Act. And, you know, I'd lend them a helping hand if they needed it. I'm about collective bargaining for the employees of the UFC and trying to improve their wages, hours, and other terms and conditions of employment that goes right to the heart economically of the fighters' pocketbooks.
I'll ask you about MMAFA in a second as well. Why didn't you call it the Professional Fighters Union if that's what you want, a union?
I could have.
Okay.
I don't know. I might take your suggestion and change it if we get elected in.
But for the record, you want a union.
Yes, a union.
So how do you, is part of the process to turn them into employees and not quote unquote independent contractors?
No, they already are employees and I'll tell you why.
Okay.
Okay. The UFC is the boss. They tell them where to fight, when to fight, what to wear when they fight. They're employees and they're full-time employees. You know what it takes to train for a fight? I mean, I was listening to John Kavanaugh speak. I mean, it's a full-time thing. But a lot of them have to have some other jobs to supplement their fighting income because their fighting income is not enough to sustain themselves.
Yeah.
That's not right.
So do you need to, like, do they need to, is that something in the contract that stated that they're an independent contractor? Do you need to change that language? Is there a way to get them recognized as employees?
Well, one of my goals would be once elected and we had a collective bargaining agreement in place, what they need is to have what I would call a uniform fighters contract. In the major sports, they have a uniform players contract. So the only thing that the agents would really be negotiating is the purse amounts.
Okay.
That's what they would be negotiating. So there needs to be a uniform fighters contract written because the contracts that I've read, which was the Diaz contracts, are just, they're baffling when you read them. I mean, it's just preposterous, the things that are in there that I don't believe are legal, valid, or enforceable. I even believe the UFC knows that, okay?
But can you give us an example?
There's no pushback. There's no pushback.
What's an example of something that you think that... Is he legal or something like that?
Well, that's necessarily illegal, but let's look at the licensing situation with Reebok. Let's talk about the Reebok deal.
Okay.
The money comes into the UFC, and then they're going to chop it up however they want. Look at the Brock Lesnar situation. They usually chop it up based upon seniority and the amount of fights that somebody had. So Brock got the least at UFC 200 because he had the least amount of seniority, but yet he was probably the biggest draw. Mm. So how is the guy who's the biggest draw making the least amount of money? How is the guy who's the biggest draw doesn't have a choice over wearing Reebok? What if Adidas wanted to do a deal with him? What if Nike wanted to do a deal with him? He's got to have the freedom to be able to negotiate, or his representatives have to have the freedom to negotiate with other groups. But no, the UFC says, you're wearing this, and this is what we're paying you, whether you like it or not. Hmm. So that's something that I look at as an agent, and I laugh at. Because that would never fly in baseball or any of the other major sports. Yet it flies in the UFC, that must change.
Part of that contract that you talk about, you say you just, okay, if they're employees, you just, as an agent, will negotiate their purse, right? So does that mean that, for example, the TV deal, which the fighters don't make any money off of now, would it be then, let's say perfect world, 50-50, right? Like the NBA. And we saw what the new TV contract did for the free agent contracts this summer, enormous amount of money being given to the players. So would there be a set contract that, like, all the fighters under the UFC contract, in your perfect world, all the fighters under the UFC contract are getting 50% of the TV deal, and it doesn't matter if you're the biggest draw, the smallest draw, you're all getting that. And then on top of that, you're then negotiating your purse. Is that what you'd like in a nutshell?
The TV revenue and the licensing money has to be shared. What percentage, that remains to be seen.
Okay.
But that money has to come, the pendulum has to swing towards the player side, or the fighter side,
yeah.
And they have to get some money. Now, what I would do is, hopefully I would establish an executive board of fighters, because the fighters are the ones going to be running the union.
Okay.
So let's just say, in my mind, I think it should be about 12 of them,
okay,
of fighters that are really passionate about the issues. They take this to heart, and we would decide, you know, how that money would be carved up amongst the fighters. Who would make what, but the money definitely needs to come in from the other side.
Now, there's no denying that before you guys came around and others came around, I know there's a group in out of New York, a group of lawyers who have sent some letters to fighters. MMAFA was the Mixed Martial Arts Fighters Association, led by Rob Macy, the first that were kind of pushing these sort of issues, I think, starting back in 2009. And as you mentioned, there's been some tweets, some comments about, you know, we're first, we're the ones who started this, let's not divide. And I think you would agree that dividing isn't the best thing. It kind of goes against the whole union concept. Did you talk to them at all before launching this? Did you feel like you had to talk to them at all before launching this?
No, I didn't feel I had a need to talk to them. I haven't spoken with them. I think they're doing something different, although there is some overlap, a little bit of overlap. I'm there to help them if they need help. I'm not a threat to them. Now, if they said that they wanted to be a competitive union, they wanted to try to get elective, well, then I'm willing to get in the ring with them. I'm willing to get in the octagon with them and duke out these issues and see who would be better to represent the fighters' interests. I'd be willing to do that, but they're doing something else, which is totally okay, and I support what they're doing.
Are you disappointed by some of this reaction? Because the story has been, okay, the PFA is a thing, but it also has been MMAFA versus PFA versus these other guys out of New York. Are you disappointed that it's now become, you know, sort of a divided front as opposed to a united front?
Not necessarily. I think that they probably look at it, and people maybe feel a little bit threatened by it, because I think that we're positioned with the support of the other unions that we're the ones that are best suited to represent the fighters' interests.
Why not reach out to them to try to squash this sort of beef?
Well, I actually had a conversation today with a fighter who I won't say who it was, who suggested that Mr. Macy is going to be in Vegas when I'm going to be in Vegas. I'm actually flying there after the show.
Okay.
And I'm open to having a conversation with him.
What is the distinction between, because I'm actually hearing from this a lot from people on Twitter, fans, even some fighters, like, what's the difference, if you can describe, between the MMAFA and the PFA?
Right. Well, once again, they're an association.
Uh-huh.
We're a union.
Okay.
They don't need to be elected to do what they do.
Okay.
We have to be elected and certified by the National Labor Relations Board to operate as a union.
How do you get that? How do you get certified?
Okay. I'll use the number 600. There's roughly 600 fighters under contract with the UFC.
Uh-huh.
So first thing you have to do is you have to get them them to sign solicitation cards, 30%. So say 180 of them sign solicitation cards, submit that to the board. Then you have an election. And if you get a majority, which would be say 301, then we would be certified. And unless the UFC recognizes as a union, and they probably won't, you get certified by the National Labor Relations Board. Then we become the exclusive agent for, you know, wages, hours, and other conditions of employment. And we negotiate with the UFC. So, but I said I wouldn't take the job if I got 301 votes, because that's going to communicate a very negative message to the UFC. It's going to show that there's different factions within the group, and they will not, the fighters will not prevail in a situation where there's, I get elected by a simple minority like the 301. I want it to be overwhelming. I want 590 of the fighters to vote it in, because that's going to communicate a message loud and clear to the UFC that they mean business and they stand together, because nothing is more important to show that all the fighters are aligned on these issues. And if they're divided, well, the UFC wins. The fighters' rights are going to be continue to be trampled upon for many, many years to come.
Your phone number is on the website. It's on the Twitter page as well, correct?
Yes.
Who have you heard from?
Lots of people.
Really?
And the people, some of it was suggested to me, you're crazy for putting your phone number out there. And I said, no. I said, there can be a bunch of lunatics out there calling me 24 hours a day. I don't care. If a fighter wants to talk to me, I want to be able to take his call morning, noon, or night.
Yeah.
That's why I put it on there. So I don't care about all this, the bizarre calls I'm getting.
Are you getting bizarre calls?
Yeah, I'm getting a ton of bizarre calls.
Really?
I'm getting a lot of calls for employment. People want to come work. That's probably the number one call.
Interesting.
Getting a lot of calls from fans, obviously. But the number one thing is I want fighters to be able to access me like that.
Okay. Have you received a lot of calls from UFC fighters?
Many.
Really?
Many.
Wow. And what are they saying? Tell me more.
There's one that stands out, which is very interesting. I won't say the fighter's name. Fighter calls me up, says he's, you know, Fighter X, right? Yep. Big name fighter.
Okay.
And says to me, how do I know this is Jeff Borris? And how do I know that this is really your phone number? And I said, well, I guess you don't. You know, he said, how do I know I'm not talking to Dana White right now? I said, wow. I guess you don't. And I said, how do I not know that you're not a mole for the UFC? I said, but I'm going to tell you something. I don't care if you are, because whatever I'm going to say to you right now is the same thing I'm going to say to the UFC. So I don't care if you're sitting, you know, in their boardroom right now and the table is surrounded by Dana, Lorenzo, you know, by William Morris and all their people, because what I'm going to say to you is the same thing that I would say to them if they were here right now.
And what is the general pitch? Like, I'm sure you're getting people who are calling you and saying, like, sell me on this. Why should I join this, right? What do you say back to them?
Give you an example. This one fighter that I'm talking about in particular, he's about 35 years of age, had 30 professional fights, something like that. So, you know, he's towards the latter stages of his career. And I said to him, wouldn't you have liked to have known, if we could turn the clock back and this was your first professional fight, wouldn't it be nice to know that you'd have a pension if you turned 65 years old? Let's say if you had 30 professional fights. You know, and the way it works in baseball, you put in 10 years of service, or you make more than the average salary 3 consecutive years, you get fully vested for a pension, which is about $175,000 a year when you turn 65 till the day you die. There's a lot of different variations on that theme that you could take, but wouldn't it be nice if you knew you had something like that? I said, currently you don't. So one of the things I would be a big advocate for is a pension for the fighters. Mm-hmm. Now, a fully pension might be vested, let's say, at 30 fights. Maybe you get a half a pension at 15 fights. I don't know. I would have to sit down with the fighters, discuss with them, give me some sort of scale. With our economist, Andrew Zimbalist, I would have to sit down with him and say, what do you think is appropriate here? And then I would go try to collectively bargain for it with the UFC. But the pension would be an example.
Andrew's involvement fascinates me. As a longtime baseball fan, I've seen a lot of his work as it pertains to the MLBPA. What exactly does he do for the association or union?
I first learned of Andrew, this was in, I think it was in the 80s, the late 80s, when I was an advocate for something called the Players League, when the owners had locked out, I think it was 94, when the owners had locked out the players. And I said, you know what? Let's do away with the owners. Let's form a Players League.
Huh.
What do you need the owners for? Okay, we'll rent the stadiums. Most of them were owned by the municipalities anyways. We would just rent them out. Only a few ballparks were actually owned by the clubs. And let the players play, and we'll carve out the middleman. The owners are the middleman. So I was an advocate for the Players League, and he was writing a lot about, I think he wrote the book Baseball and Billions at that time. And that's when I started following him, and he's the leading economist in the nation regarding sports. And so he was another guy, one of my first phone calls, and I said, Andrew, I said, listen, this is what I'm attempting to do. I said, I'm not an economist, I'm a lawyer, I'm not an economist. I want you to help me regarding the economics of this. And he said he'd be happy to.
Brilliant guy.
Very.
Love reading his stuff. A lot of other people say to me, you focus solely on the UFC. It doesn't say MMA fighters. Why do you only care about the UFC? Why are you focusing solely on the UFC here?
That's interesting. There are other fighting leagues like Bellator, yeah, the World Series. The difference is, and the reason why, is the UFC is really the premier league. It's the premier league, and they have 600 people under contract, fighters, that they're employees. That's why we're focusing on the UFC. I was talking to a fighter today, give you this as an example, because the fighter said, let's say I became part of the union with the UFC, and Bellator offered me a bigger contract to go fight. My contract was up with the UFC, and my agent got me a better deal with Bellator. What would happen? I'd say, that's no different than what I do in Major League Baseball. Guy's contract is up, and I get more money from a club in Japan. Hmm. He leaves the Major League Baseball Players Union, and he goes to Japan.
Okay.
You're free to go to Bellator.
Okay.
Your contract's up with the UFC. I said, but if you're under contract with the UFC, and you're going to be part of that union, there's a big difference there.
Could you have a union that encompasses the Bellators and the World Series, or because the UFC has its own TV deal, the uniform, things like that, it's impossible to have one large union?
Probably not impossible, but I think for right now, I think I want to treat the UFC and give them the same respect that they would if they were the NFL, the NBA, MLB.
Mm-hmm. A lot of other people have said to me, oh, great, this is the demise of MMA. We're going to see a strike. The fighters are going to, as you can see, I'm a longtime Montreal Expos fan. No one knows the pain of a strike more than myself. 1994, you mentioned it earlier, the best team in baseball. We got screwed. Were you behind that strike, by the way?
No, I was not behind that
Were you strike. Advocating for the damn strike?
No, I was not.
By the way, it's funny that we're talking about it. August 12th, 1994, so 22 years ago is when they went on strike.
Actually, I take that back. Yes, I was a proponent.
Come on,
I was a proponent of the strike. From a fan point of view, from a fan point of view, no. But from working in the business, it was the right thing to do at the right time, and it advanced the rights of the baseball players.
Right.
It definitely did.
As a 12-year-old, I couldn't really understand that. I was devastated.
I understand.
As you can imagine.
I remember that team very well.
Yes. Did you have any players on that team?
I think I had quite a few. I remember the guys on there. It was Pedro Martinez, Matt Williams.
Not Matt Williams. Matt Williams was on the Giants.
And he was on pace to break Roger Maris's record. Alou, Tim Wallach.
John Wetland.
Wetland, yeah.
Did you have any of those guys?
None of those guys, no.
Then I would have asked for your autograph. But my question is, a lot of people say, they're going to go on strike. I'm going to lose the fights. I'm not going to get the matchups that I want. What do you say to those fans? What do you say to those fans who say that this is going to ruin? Because when they start thinking, at the end of the day, the sports fans just want to see the games, right? They just want to see, they don't care about PEDs. Just give me the damn game. Give me the fight. And now this potentially throws a wrench in that. What's your response to that concern?
I think in the court of public opinion, the fighters win.
Uh-huh.
And the reason why the fighters would win in the court of public opinion, if they understood exactly to what degree the fighters were exploited. I mean, it's very easy to see, Diaz and McGregor fighting this weekend and making millions of dollars and thinking, oh, this is very glamorous, this is great. But that's not the masses. Mm. What about the guys on the undercard who are fighting for 10 and 10, right? Mm. 10 to show, 10 to win. How much money does it cost them to put on their camp to fight? How much money do they have to pay their corner? So I think in the court of public opinion, if the public knew that they don't have any medical insurance, shouldn't they have medical insurance? I mean, I talked about a pension. How about medical insurance? I mean, the Obama administration was big on making sure that medical care was affordable to everybody. A lot of these men and women of the UFC, they don't have any medical insurance. Mm.
And to be clear, it's like in-training insurance, right? But if they get hit by a car walking to the grocery store, they're not covered.
Correct. Right. I'm not talking about what happens when they're in the octagon. Yeah, I'm talking about, in general, everyday medical insurance when their kid gets the flu to be able to take them to the doctor.
Right. Yeah, of course. That is a very strong point. So you say that you've been, people have reached out to you, your phone number, whatnot. You also said you're going to Las Vegas. Why are you going to Las Vegas?
Because that's where the fighters are.
Okay.
That's where the fighters are. I'm going to be there, and I'm going to be talking to every UFC fighter that crosses my path.
You're just going to be walking around.
Well, I have other things to do there. I have lots of meetings that are already set up.
Okay.
We're planning on having a press conference on Thursday where we could address the media all at one time.
Yep.
I've been silent since the press release on Thursday, which has been very hard to do.
Uh-huh.
But I wanted to break the news on your show because I know that you reach out to so many people, and I want to thank you for that.
Yeah.
But Thursday we'll have a press conference where we can address all the media.
Obviously, I've seen some fighters tweet about it a little bit, but I haven't seen many fighters like come out and publicly support it. Are there any fighters that you can say are in support of this union?
I've made promises to every fighter that I've talked to that I will not use their name.
Okay.
Because I don't want the UFC to, if the fighters are right and the UFC wants to retaliate, I don't want them to retaliate against one fighter. Uh-huh. I'll start mentioning names when I have 500 guys in my hip pocket.
Oh, okay. What about at this press conference?
Like, I won't mention any names there either.
Okay. You won't have any fighters show up. This is going to be you explaining things, talking about things.
There might be a fighter sitting at the table with me.
Okay.
There may be. I'm not there making any promises,
that's a tease.
But there may be.
Again, on your website, it's interesting. You have these little pie graphs, right? The revenue share between the NBA, NFL, MLB, NHL, and then the UFC. In those sports, everything is pretty much public. LeBron James signs for 3 years, $100 million. We know that right off the bat. In our sport, it's a little different, as you know. Your pie graph, I think, is 15 for the fighters, 15%, 85 for the UFC, correct? Is that the number?
Something like that. When I talked about when I was doing research.
Yeah.
I got that from a quote from Lorenzo that's on the internet. You can Google it.
Okay.
Where he's saying something that the division is somewhere 86, 14, 85, something like that. Do I know that to be true? No.
Because you don't have access to the books.
I don't have access to their books and records, and I'm not saying I'm entitled to. And let's say what Lorenzo said on the internet was not misconstrued, was not taken out of context, and let's say it was accurate. Okay. Why are all the other major sports all close to the middle?
Uh-huh.
They're all close to the middle, give or take a little bit. Maybe the UFC should be, and I know they're going to hate hearing what I'm saying right now, should be close to the middle. Now, I'm not saying that overnight we get certified as a union and we go from 14% to 50%, but there's got to be an edging up along the way. Hmm. It'd be a process to get to that number ultimately one day, but there has to be something. Like I said, the pendulum's got to swing to the sides of the fighters sooner or later.
Would you like to meet with the UFC while in Vegas?
What I would like to have happen is that the UFC understands what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
They respect it in a business sense. I don't begrudge the UFC. I'm a fan of the UFC's business model. I think they've done tremendous. I think their $4 billion sale is well-deserved, and they're to be, you know, applauded for what they've done. And they should be concerned with their bottom line, but these fighters do also. They're the ones that drive their business. I would like them to respect that in a professional atmosphere and just compensate the fighters appropriately.
But, you know, let's say someone reaches out to you. Hey, Jeff. Let's talk about this. Let's talk what the heck you're doing here. Are you open to sitting down and talking to them about where you're coming from, why you launched this?
Yes, absolutely. I would like to think that would happen, but I'm not optimistic.
Do you need to reach out to them? Like, is it important for you to establish some kind of line of communication or no?
Okay, I'd like to officially invite Dana right now to the press conference on Thursday
okay.
to talk about these issues.
Okay, but that doesn't have to happen.
No.
Okay.
It probably won't.
Right.
I would like him to show. Maybe he will. Maybe he won't. I don't know.
For the layman, for people like myself who, you know, aren't entrenched in this, what are the steps that need to happen for this to become a thing? Like, what are you looking at, and what kind of timeline? Does it take a year to make a unit? 6 months? What can you tell us about the timeline?
Yeah, that's the hard part.
Okay.
The hard part is, I want to, even though, for instance, on this show, I'm sure there's many, many fighters that are watching the show right now. I want to meet with those fighters. I want to meet with them on an individual basis. I want to meet with them in maybe a small group. And that's going to take me some time because I want them to get to know me. I want them to get a comfort level and a feel for what my objectives are. I mean, it's nice coming on a show like this and you might be able to get a feel,
sure.
but I want them to get to know me in person. So we're going to go city to city, fight to fight. And
so you're going to start traveling to all these fights.
Yes.
Wow.
And I'm thinking, I don't know, maybe 6 months.
6 months.
Something like that.
6 months till you get what you want?
Well, let's if I was talking to 10 fighters a day.
Yeah.
Just over the course of a month, I hit 300 of them. You know, now that, like I said, that might be optimistic. I mean, there's some days I might talk to one or two. There's some days I might talk to 25. But I realize that it's going to take me some time and it's going to be hard to do. But I'm a tireless worker and I don't mind it. And I've spent my last 30 years on the road and I don't spend, mind spending the next 6 months on the road
right.
and just getting in front of all these fighters and getting the word out.
What do you say to the person who says, Jeff Borris sees the $4 billion number. He sees a lot more money to be made. He just wants money. He smells the money. He wants money. What do you say to those people?
No, that's funny. I mean, I was actually talking to a fighter today about compensation or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I've had an enormously successful baseball practice for 30 years that I'm very appreciative of. But this is what I said to the fighter today who was talking to me about compensation. I said, I don't determine what I'm going to make. The fighters do.
Mm.
And let's say I get voted in as the executive director of the union.
Because you're not that right now, right?
Right. Nothing.
You're just the guy trying.
It's grassroots. Nothing until it's something.
Yeah, right.
So I get elected in as the executive director. What happens next? I go out and I try to get these things for the fighters, right? The pensions, the minimums, the medical insurance, all these things. and I fail in all these objectives, what's going to happen? The fighters are going to fire me.
Right.
Right? Now, let's say I go out there and I'm successful. I get all these things and then some. And then I get a licensing deal, a merchandising deal, share the television revenue, whatever. And everybody's benefiting and making more money. The fighters, the board, the executive board of fighters, they're going to determine what type of salary I should or should not get. They're the ones. And that's up in the air. So I'm obviously not going to get something that I'm not entitled to, and I'm not determining what I'm going to get. It's the fighters who are going to be determining that.
Do you think it is going to be tougher to get the big draws? Again, the Connors, the Cormiers, the Rondas, the Anderson Silvas of the world to get on board? Or is it the 10 and 10 guys, as you mentioned, the entry-level guys, the mid-tier guys? Who do you think is going to be the toughest to sell on this?
Every fighter that I've talked to, from the 10 and 10 guy up to the biggest name type guys and any guys in between, they're all very similar when you're talking to them. They all want it. They all need it. They all recognize it. None of them are opposed to it. Like I said, the only thing that I'm noticing is they all mention the retaliatory effects that could possibly come out of it. And I keep trying to tell them, don't worry about it. It's not going to happen. Give me 600 of you in my hip pocket, I got a fair fight.
Are you starting to feel like the fighters, because this is sort of a mano-a-mano sport, you know, it's not a team sport per se. I mean, like, you know, I don't need to team up with this guy. I've worked hard. I've been doing this for 10 years. I'm finally here. I have two kids and a wife. I can't stick my neck out on the line. Like, how are you going to, because I understand what you're saying, but how are you going to convince that guy to do it? You know, he's the champion. He finally got the belt. He's finally living the good life. And now I'm going to stick out my neck for the guys who are going to fight in 10 years. I hear that a lot from people, as I'm sure you do as well. Mm-hmm. What do you say to that guy?
What they say in baseball, same thing. The fighters of today, they owe a debt of gratitude to the fighters that came before them, like the Gracies.
They owe
a debt of gratitude. They owe a debt of gratitude to the people that they're fighting alongside of today, because they need each other to coexist, and they have an obligation to the future fighters that are going to come behind them.
Are you confident that this will happen regardless? Like, this is inevitable at this point? That maybe, for whatever reason, it's not you, and it, like, this has to happen, basically, in the UFC? Are you confident of that?
Well, I'm kind of arrogant thinking that I'm the best and my team's the best for the job. I'm kind of arrogant and thinking if we don't get voted in, it's not going to be anybody.
Okay.
But obviously, if it doesn't happen now, when is it going to happen? If we use that, the tag phrase, it's time now for a change.
Yeah.
If it doesn't happen now, when is it going to happen? It's not going to happen 10 years from now. It has to happen now.
You mentioned your team. How many people are part of this team?
Well, the four that we listed on the website, and right now, I'm like, for instance, I'm trying to get a hold of a concussion specialist.
Okay.
You know, I remember I saw the movie, Will Smith starred in, thinking, you know what, I got to get a concussion specialist because these guys get pounded in the head.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe an orthopedist and something like that. So I'm in the process of assembling a team because, like I said, it's not a one-man show.
Okay, so you're looking to add a few more.
Yes.
Do you still work for Balenji?
I'm of counsel to Balenji.
Okay, how does that work? Do you have to separate from them because they represent fighters as well? How does that work?
Yes, I am not a fighter agent. I've never been a fighter agent, nor do I want to become a fighter agent.
Okay.
I'm a baseball agent, and I have been for 30 years. Will continue to do so, and I can do many things at one time.
Okay, so that was actually my next question. You are going to remain a baseball agent.
Yes.
Any of your baseball clients, I don't know how big of a fan they are, any of them reach out like, hey, Jeff, what the heck are you doing?
I've talked to all of them about it.
Really?
They love it.
They love it.
They're fight fans.
Sure.
In fact, we had a party in spring training this year, and I had some fighters over there. And my baseball players were enamored with the fighters. I mean, guys were making more than McGregor money, who are enamored with the fighters. And they just, to quote Nick Diaz, is, you know, we entertain the entertainers.
That's right.
It's a great quote by him. And so I'm thinking about that. Well, yeah, these baseball players, and they're being entertained by you.
Yeah.
So they're all in support of it. They all love it. They can't believe that these guys aren't unionized, because they understand the importance and how crucial it is to have a union to advance their rights.
Do you think you'll be able to do both? If you are named executive director, you can still keep doing whatever it is you do as a baseball agent.
Absolutely.
Have you studied, you know, the Curt Flood story and Marvin Miller, I believe it is, you know, I think, what was the year, 1970 or 71 to 72? Have you studied the way other unions were born and the obstacles that they face? I know the tennis, the ATP players in 73, the Wimbledon, they had a strike as well. Have you looked at this stuff as well?
Yes, I was a professor of sports law at Southwestern University for 9 years.
Wow.
It was a great job. Okay. I quit when my oldest daughter was born because it took away too much time. I would rather read her a bedtime story than read a second-year law student's blue book exam. But I taught sports law for 9 years, so I had to educate myself on all the sports and all the different basic agreements that they have. So I'm very well-versed in all the other sports. Okay.
What do you think the reception is going to be like in Las Vegas when you go out there tonight? What are you expecting?
Well, if I walk around with the shirt on at my Target...
Is that what you are going to do?
I'm going to have the shirt on, yes. Okay. I have several of them. I have some in different colors.
Okay. Wow. Look at you. What colors you got?
white and gray.
Okay.
I hope that a fighter, I could be walking by, I might not know who they are, they might see me, they see me with the shirt,
okay,
I want to be approached.
Yeah.
I hope they come up to me and say, hey, could I, you know, spend 5-10 minutes talking to you about the issues.
Yeah, and you're going to be open to it.
Yes.
And what about with regards to the UFC? Are you going to try to like nudge your way in there to things and really make a stink, or are you going to lay back?
I'm going to be professional if I see any UFC execs anywhere and say I'm open to talk to you anytime. I realize they might not recognize me because we're nothing yet, because it's not in existence.
Yeah.
The Professional Fighters Organization has not been elected. So I think you had on your show the other day, I forget who it was, but first comment was, you're nothing until you're something.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
We're nothing right now. So, but I don't know. I'm hoping that we'll be a force to be reckoned with, and sooner than later.
Thus far, less than a week after launching, are you happy with the progress? I know there hasn't been a lot done, but just the reaction, the media reaction. Overall, are you content with where you're at? I know you were anxious to speak and get the word out, and I know Lucas Middlebrook, who's a part of your team as well, who's well-respected. He's been on the show before talking about his work with Nick Diaz. Overall, are you happy with where you're at?
Yes, very happy, but I get a little over-anxious.
Okay.
I feel that there's so much work out there to do.
Yeah.
And let's say when I'm flying on the plane tonight from New York to Vegas, those 5 hours, how many phone calls am I missing? How many fighters are going to be calling me? If just one fighter an hour called me during those 5 hours, those five calls that I just missed.
Yeah.
You know, and I would explain to him, hey, I was flying coast to coast whatever, and I'm returning your call now. But I get anxious about that. I want to get the word out. And so the next 6 months probably going to kill me.
Yeah. Well, I hope not, because then the whole thing is for naught.
Right.
Okay. So the next step is you're going to Vegas. You're going to collect as much data as possible, talk to as many people as possible, potentially put on a press conference, correct?
Thursday.
And then just sort of build from there. There's nothing as far as like union. Do you have to pass out union cards, things like that? How does that work?
I'll let Lucas take care of that. Lucas will be the...
Will he be there as well?
I believe he's going to be.
Okay.
He'll be the nuts and bolts of how the solicitation cards get sent out, get signed. I think he was telling me it could be done electronically, so I'll let him take care of that.
Okay, fair enough. And what's the message finally to these other groups that are trying, the MMA phase? What's the message? Let's all get on the same page. Stand out of my way. Like, what ultimately do you want to say to these people? Because you have not talked to them, correct? What would you like to say to them if they're watching?
Just to acknowledge what we're doing, that I ought to become their best friend. It's like when I call up an agent, right? The first thing they might think to themselves, oh, is he going to try to take my guy? No, that's not what I'm about. Actually, I'm your best friend, because if what I do is successful, there's going to be more money in it for everybody. Mm. It's not just the fighters. It would be their representatives as well. And so when you talk about the MMAFA or the Ali Act or things like that, I respect what they're doing. I support what they're doing. And I hope that they give me the same type of deference.
Would you like to see the Ali Act come over to MMA as well?
Absolutely.
There's
many things in the Ali Act that are beneficial that I think should have been in existence for many, many years. If it happens, great.
But this is not something that you are going to work on. Not something that you're trying to do right now.
That's not part of my agenda, no. Because I'm just, like I said, I'm just dealing with the economic issues that go right to the heart of the fighters' pocketbooks.
Okay. And what about, you know, their breakdown is, they talk, obviously their big initiative is the Ali Act. Also, they're a part of this class action lawsuit, right? How do you feel about that? Are you in support of that? Do you feel like that's the right thing that they should be doing? Right, you know, they have some fighters who are listening. I'm sure you've read about the class action lawsuit. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, they have some sort of antitrust lawsuit, which I know you cannot have as a union. It would be an unfair labor practice. But like on that, I would defer to Lucas on that one as well.
Okay. But it sounds to me, though, like if they have their lawsuit, if they have the Ali Act mission and you're trying to focus on the economic, that you can kind of both coexist in this world, right?
That's my position, absolutely. That's okay. Why reading these tweets coming from them, it's a little disheartening. I mean, my first thought is, because in my heart I'm a fighter, it's I want to fight them back, sure, right? Sure. I want to start saying, that's not right, you're wrong. But then it's like, maybe, I'm going to take the high road here and do what's right. And what's right is I'm in a different direction than them. Hmm. There is some overlap, but nothing where we couldn't coexist.
Okay. Is there anything that we didn't, this is sort of like an FAQ, so to speak, like a virtual one. Is there anything that we didn't touch on that you wanted to address?
No, I just, like I said, I appreciate being on your show because I know you reach out to so many, and that's why I wanted to break the story here on your show. So I mean,
well, technically we didn't break it on the show. It actually broke, but fair enough. The first time you speak,
they're
about
hearing
it.
From me. I haven't spoken publicly about it. In fact, tomorrow my whole day is
media,
almost the entire day.
Have you received interest from the non-MMA press as well? People
yes.
that deal with, like the mainstream sports press that knows all about agents and unions and things like that, are they interested in this story? Sometimes we have a hard time breaking through as a sport.
Yes, most of the time, I don't know, I wouldn't underestimate it. Yeah, most of the time it is MMA-based stuff, but there are other interested media outlets that have interest in this.
Fascinating. What a time.
Yeah, exciting.
What a time in this sport. One last thing, the TV deal is coming up. It was that important to get this established before they start negotiating that? Because that has to be a part of this as well, right?
It's a factor.
Okay.
It's a factor. Whether they get a good TV deal, bad TV deal, whatever it is, a part of that's got to come the fighter's way.
Okay. This time next year, August of 2017, do you think that you guys are a thriving union, that you guys are well-oiled machine doing your thing?
I'd love to come on the show 1 year from now to celebrate the one-year anniversary of the union.
Wow.
That would be great.
Okay, we can replay this clip. Yes. How about that? I appreciate it. Thank you very much. By the way, what's Barry doing these days?
He's a hitting coach for the Marlins.
Yeah.
He's loving it.
They're killing it.
Oh, yeah.
They're making a run, right?
Absolutely.
He enjoys it?
Loves it.
I never thought Barry Bonds would be a coach.
He's a great teacher.
He is.
Yeah. Yeah.
What a story. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. I got his autograph once as a youngster. He actually got mad at me because I asked him to sign it with a Sharpie, and he said, no, I'm signing with my pen. Sometimes a prickly fellow, but that's his charm.
He can be.
Yeah.
He can be.
Tell him I say hi.
I will do that.
Congratulations on the launch. And obviously, best of luck with this.
Thank you.
I will probably see you out there roaming the halls of the MGM.
Okay.
There he is, Jeff Borris of the Professional Fighters Association. Their website, as I mentioned, profighters.org. Their Twitter handle is Fighters Assos, FIGHTERSASSOC. That's their Twitter handle. They've been active. Some very nice graphics with the heads of these Players Association. Their quotes. Very interesting stuff. I wish you guys the best of luck.
Thank you, Ariel.